Hello. Good afternoon. Welcome back from lunch. How was the conversation at lunch? Let's do, because this is about science, let's do like a show of hands. We'll have a three-point scale. We'll do like thumbs up, neutral, down. Food quality? All right, I don't see any neutrals at all. Stacy is even standing up. Quality of the conversation? Whoa, even better. What's been the biggest takeaway from the morning? And you're not allowed to say Zingerman's candy bar. Throw it out.
Disagreement about how to go forward.
Excellent. Yes.
Ownership.
Yes.
How to get happy.
How do you get happy? Perfect. It's as if you were all listening rather than checking email. That's amazing. Thank you. With that demonstration of sophisticated survey techniques, we now conclude our HR Made Science panel. Thank you very much. Now, we've assembled an amazing set of panelists this afternoon. We wanted to really showcase not just the beginning of how HR and science get together, but what are the frontiers of analytics and science in the HR field. And before I get all of our panelists here on stage, I wanted to start off and share with you our own experience here at Google of how we have had science and HR meet. So 7 years back, when I joined Google, one of our first exercises was to develop a rallying cry for our newly founded people analytics team. And we came up with something that resonates even today and is going to keep us busy for a long, long time. And for those of you who can't recognize this underused font called Prasad Setty's handwriting, it says, all people decisions at Google should be based on data and analytics. After all, an organization our size makes thousands of people decisions every year. Who should we hire? Who should we promote? How much should we pay our best people? And so on and on. And in an innovation and people-based organization like ours, these decisions are no less important than how we think about our product strategy, how we think about our go-to-market strategy, how we think about our business plans, et cetera. So we thought analytics should help influence all of our people decisions. Now, initially, we aspired for living up to a very strong form of this mission statement. We wanted analytics to spit out people decisions. And an early experience at Google changed my mind on what my team should actually be working on. And to share this learning with you, I have to describe one of the rituals that make Google what it is. And this actually takes place a few miles south. Here's the Santa Clara Marriott, seemingly just another chain hotel. But in reality, what it hides behind its beautiful facade is that it's the setting for some of the most important people decisions we make at Google, promotions of our software engineers. Promotions are a big deal at Google. Twice a year, thousands of Googlers get promoted to positions of higher responsibility. And in our technical side, the process includes the following. We bring in hundreds of our senior-most engineers from all around the world to the Bay Area. We form committees of 4 to 5 people each, and we have each committee review a stack of nominations. And then they make a decision after lots and lots of conversation. We don't have enough conference rooms at Google, and that's why we have to use up most of the Santa Clara Marriott. In engineering, people can self-nominate themselves for promotions. There are appeals committees in case you disagree with the primary committee's recommendation. There are appeals of appeals committees. This is like the Supreme Court process, except that our committee members are a little younger. And we thought that given all this effort that goes into making these promotion decisions, people analytics could help our engineering brothers and sisters make these decisions more efficiently. So we looked at all the information that was available to the committees, and we came up with a decision-making model. A simple logit, nothing too fancy. This is no E equals MC squared. This is a pretty ugly formula, but it works. What we found was that it was reliable. It back-tested very well. It was stable across multiple cycles. And for almost a third of our promotion cases, with 90% accuracy, you could just use this model to make the right decision. We were excited. We thought that we would go to our engineers and tell them we can immediately cut committee workload by 30% if we use the model to make these promotion decisions. We thought that these people who lived in the world of search and ads algorithms all day long would love this. They didn't like it one bit. They didn't want to hide behind a black box. They wanted to own the decisions. They didn't want to use a model to do so. The one thing that they did find interesting about this model was actually something that it was missing. There was one critical factor that folklore had established was crucial in informing promotion decisions. And when we looked at our model and built it, that particular factor was missing. It was nowhere to be seen. And so that led to a rich conversation among the committee members about what is the importance of that factor? Are we all using it the right way? What role should it play in the future? That was the biggest learning for them. They didn't want to use the model to make decisions for them, but they wanted to use it to examine their own decision-making process. I took away a very different learning for our team about that. And this is like a Homer Simpson duh moment, right? We should let people make people decisions. People analytics wasn't going to be in the business of developing algorithms to substitute for or replace human decision makers. Instead, what we were going to be all about was to arm these people with much better, relevant information so that they can be capable of making better decisions. But what context, what is like the context behind which you supply this relevant information? What are the characteristics of doing so? A second project illustrated for us what that actually looks like. And Laszlo brought it up earlier this morning. And this is something that we have shared extensively externally too, but let me give you my version of it. A few years back, we asked ourselves, do people managers matter at Google? And this wasn't just a theoretical question for us. We actually wanted to show that they didn't, because then we could design an organization with boundless levels of autonomy. And selfishly for me, I wouldn't have to listen to Laszlo. I love that, so I always listen to it, always do. What we actually found was the opposite. We failed miserably at proving that managers didn't matter. We saw that our best managers had much better retention rates for their teams. They had much better performance for their teams. We then dug into and did some double-blind interviews to figure out, is this just happening by chance or is it by conscious action? And we found that our best managers were exhibiting eight attributes, eight behaviors, consistently that our poor ones weren't. And this is what we codified and published externally as well as our Project Oxygen research. But we didn't stop at the research phase. All of People Operations got together and came up with ways to live up to these attributes. So we use these dimensions when we are filling new people manager roles. We have learning programs to help managers improve their capabilities on these eight dimensions. And for the past few years, every 6 months, each manager at Google has been rated by their Googlers, by their direct reports on these dimensions, and they get an individualized report like this, purely for developmental reasons. And after all these years, by any segment that you cut our manager population, across functions, regions, across their tenure as a manager, whether they started out being our best or our average or our poor managers, scores have increased all over, across all segments. Oxygen has been very successful at Google. What we asked ourselves was, why? It's not like we came up with a new model of management. All of these are principles that have already been established in the literature, right? But in the past, we used to tell our managers, hey, you need to focus on improving your capabilities because that is what leaders at successful organizations do. Our managers didn't listen, given all the priorities that they had. Instead, with Oxygen, we were able to go back to them and say, this is why it matters for you and your team and the organization, and this is how you can personally benefit and learn from it. Our research that was internal to Google and translating that research into something that was personally meaningful for each of these people trumped best practice. And for all the academics in the room, there are many of you, you'll be very happy to know that whenever we are faced with a new people issue at Google now, we don't ask ourselves, what does successful organization X do with this topic? Instead, we ask ourselves, what does the literature say? And if I have one piece of advice to give all the businesses that are in the audience out here, it is develop better relationships with academics than with consulting firms. Thank you. we've used this approach where we start with what's established in the academic literature and then do our own research and our own experiments at Google to great success in a whole bunch of areas. It's not just about people management, selection, onboarding, development of all Googlers, not just our managers, organizational design, performance management, well-being. I could go on and on and on. So where do we go from here? We continue to make sure that our organization is getting more capable at making better people decisions. We continue to arm our leaders and managers with information that is rooted in research and relevant within the Google context. But we want to broaden our net further. A few years back, Laszlo came to us with a crazy idea. Now, Laszlo comes up with crazy ideas all the time. Usually, I ignore it because they have a half-life of a minute. But in this particular case, he was very persistent. One of the unwritten job key characteristics of my own job is knowing plain crazy from serious crazy. And in this particular one, Laszlo had a strong conviction that we should do something along the lines of the Framingham Heart Study. In the interest of time, I won't go into the Framingham Heart Study, but it's one of these longitudinal studies that has been in, around since 1948 and is the source of most of our commonly known findings around the spread of heart disease. We didn't want to study heart disease, but we wanted to use that type of longitudinal technique to see what role does work play in people's careers and over their lives, and what is the meaning that it has in that. So GDNA, our own longitudinal study, was born. Over the last couple of years, thousands of Googlers have enlisted and opted in to be part of GDNA. We plan to follow them through their careers at Google and even beyond. We hope to run this particular study for decades, so we are very, very early in our project lifecycle. Every 6 months, our GDNA panelists get a survey from us, asking them about personal characteristics, attitudes, perceptions, their beliefs. We ask them to solve some problems on a wide variety of topics, anything that's been associated with either work or life happiness. We already have some population level statistics that we just didn't know in the past. For instance, we know now that our engineers are less susceptible to sunk cost biases than our sales Googlers. We know that people who are better networked at Google have better performance and higher promotion rates. To Laszlo's point about the office space clip, we know that people who have an innate sense of gratitude at Google stay happier with work for a much longer period in their careers. Usually in organizations, what you'll see is that people are happy at the beginning of their tenure, and then it slowly decays. We tell our new Googlers, savor this moment, because this is the happiest you'll ever be at Google, right? But when you cut the data by gratitude, you find that those who have an innate sense of gratitude, and this is what Sean was talking about too, their score stays stable over time. And so we are now using this information to do experiments based on what's been done in the positive psychology literature to see if we can prime gratitude in even those who don't perhaps have an innate sense of it. But more important than all these population level stats is how Googlers have individually responded to GDNA. One of the early decisions we made about GDNA was that we would send back information to each Googler who took part in the surveys. We would tell them how they scored in these dimensions, how they related to Google at large. We gave them links and resources to learn more about these theoretical constructs and how they could perhaps take action. And in response, thousands of Googlers have come back to us and said, this is what I've done because of GDNA. I look forward to the survey. It is fun. It is engaging. It helps me with time for introspection. And I don't have time to go through all of these, but as you quickly scan through them, you can see the depth of reflection, the richness of perspective, the commitment to action, just based on taking a survey. I hope this gives you a glimpse of where we are headed. We want to empower every single person to know much more about themselves, be more aware, about themselves as well as the surroundings around them. We want to not tell people what to do, but we want them to be capable of all people making decisions based on data and analytics. And when I say that, we don't mean robotically respond to this information. Oh, you showed me X and therefore I must do Y. But instead, reflect on it and respond with all the intricacy, the nuance, the judgment that we as humans are capable of. We want people to be rooted in science, but as one of my colleagues, Janet Cho, likes to say, life isn't an algorithm, and we don't intend to make it one. Thank you.
You're going to keep going. Okay.
Sorry, man. I now want to introduce our panelists, and then they're each going to do a little bit of a talk about their own perspective on science and analytics in the HR space, and then we'll do a Q&A. But when we assembled this amazing group, as you'll find out soon from their stories, as I mentioned earlier, we wanted to see what is at the frontier of analytics and science here. Ben is going to talk about cutting-edge technology that is going to help us. Paul is going to talk about how do you scale this to some of the biggest organizations out there. Google at 50,000 people is a microcosm of what the US Army is. And Katie is going to talk about all the new research in science and all the cool experiments that she's running that are just going to be very, very key for all of us HR professionals.